the Gospels, you discover that there were crisis moments in the life of Christ. Choices were made that stand for time and eternity, and that, of course, is true for you and me as well. I look back upon my life and realize that again and again I have stood at the crossroads. The choices I made impacted all of my life and the lives of those around me. Well, Jesus entered the world by miracle. We talk about his incarnation. At 12 in Jerusalem, he was about his father's business. At 30, he was baptized by John in the Jordan, confirmed by the voice of God, and anointed by the Holy Spirit. And then in the wilderness, tempted of the devil, Jesus said no to every suggestion of the devil. Today we come to Matthew chapter 17 and his transfiguration. Here is the record. Our Lord is quickly completing his earthly ministry. The tides have turned against him, and more people are calling for him to be removed. The people who once clamored to make him a king have fallen away until Jesus says to his disciples, "Will you also go away?" Light had come into the world, and men loved darkness because their deeds were evil. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Our Lord, of course, was not surprised at this turn of events. He is traveling toward the cross. He said the Son of Man must suffer all of these things and the third day rise again. He said that the grain of wheat must fall into the ground and die, or there will be no harvest. We know, of course, that Jesus was both human and divine. He was human enough to wonder if there wasn't any other way to redeem a world but Calvary. Well, Jesus takes three of his nearest disciples, Peter, James, and John, into a lonely place where he can pray. Matthew 17 tells the story. While Jesus is praying, his face and his garments become whiter than any laundry on earth can whiten them. The glory of his divinity shines through the veneer of his humanity. And Peter, James, and John behold his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The wonder of that experience lingered with those disciples, and Peter and John both refer to the Holy Mount in their later epistles. Moses and Elijah appear and talk with Jesus about his death, soon to be accomplished in Jerusalem. That is all we are told. But Peter is so awestruck that he wants to build three shrines, one for Jesus and one for Moses and one for Elijah. I'm not surprised that he wanted to stay there forever. A glimpse of the glory of God's future kingdom will leave you gasping for words. We call it the transfiguration of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it gives us some lessons that we need to learn. First of all, it tells us who Jesus is. He's the Lord of glory. He's God manifest in the flesh. He's the great creator who became our Savior. He is the one in whom all fullness dwells. He was before all things, and by him all things were made. Without him not anything made that was made. And so that experience reminds us of who Jesus really is. Secondly, it tells us much about the state of our sainted dead. Moses died on Mount Nebo. Elijah was raptured in a chariot of fire. But those two are not waiting unconscious for a future awakening. Now, Jesus taught, now they are alive unto God, and God is not the God of the dead, he's the God of the living. They know, Moses, Elijah, right now, and back then knew what was going on. They are fully aware of the scriptures and in ways far beyond our understanding are able to participate in God's program in our world. That is true not only of Moses and Elijah, that is true of your loved ones who have gone on ahead. And so the experience of Jesus in his transfiguration teaches us who he is, teaches us much about our sainted dead, and thirdly, it tells us that the cross of Christ is the greatest theme that can ever occupy the minds, the attention of human beings in this earth. Moses represented the law. Elijah represented the prophets. But on the holy mountain, they did not talk about the Ten Commandments or the Golden Rule or the temple in Jerusalem. What was their theme? Their theme was Christ's death, soon to be accomplished in Jerusalem. They talked about the cross, the atoning work of Christ, the vicarious suffering of the Lamb of God, the once-for-all sacrifice for the sins of all the world. That was their conversation. And that, my friend, is the greatest theme that can claim the attention of men or angels. Check it out. Every church that is alive today is talking about the cross of Christ. The churches that are dying today are the ones who have some other agenda. When a friend of mine was gloriously converted out of a life of crime, he asked Dr. Hyman Appleman how he should preach. Dr. Appleman said, just go and tell the world about heaven and the cross, and God will bless you. Well, that is the secret to success. It is a surefire solution. As I conclude today, let me glory for a few moments in the cross of Christ. Let me talk about the person of the cross. He was not a criminal, he was the Lamb of God. And let me talk about the work of the cross, redeeming a lost humanity. Let me talk about the universal blessings, the eternal blessings flowing from the cross. Heaven and all of its joys, and our meeting Christ and being like him one day. And let me talk about the universal provisions of the cross, so that whosoever will may come and take the water of life freely. It was St. Paul who said, God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I'd like to follow in his train and just glory in the cross of Christ. It will be my endless theme in glory. It will be my password at the gates of the city of God. Do you want to know peace? Do you want to have assurance of eternal life? The old hymn that all of us know so well and love so much has the answer. It says, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked, come to thee for dress, helpless, look to thee for grace. Foul, I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. On the Mount of Transfiguration, Moses and Jesus and Elijah talked about the cross, and there's no greater subject. That today is my message. There's life for a look at the crucified one. You can have peace with God. You can know that heaven is your home. You can know that all of your sins are forgiven and buried in the sea of God's forgetfulness. You can know that the arms of God are wide open, waiting for you to come, just like the father of the prodigal waited for his son to come from the far country. That boy came to himself and said, I will arise and go to my father. You can do the same. Not tomorrow, not next week, not next year. You have no promise for that. But you can say, today I will arise and go to God and receive his gift of eternal life. Yes, I do.
for joining Pastor Barber today. Please watch For Faith to Live By again next Sunday at this same time on this same station. Until then, Faith to Live By prays that the peace of God will fill your heart and that the joy of the Lord will be your strength. Pastor Barber would love to hear from you. The mailing address is Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3C 2H6.